This is the first public performance tonight, and this is the first school performance we're having in this building. And as Mr. Belita said, a very, very special concert. It's also a very, very special day because we have a very, very great musician coming to join us for the day. In fact, he's probably going to be here in a few minutes. And his name is Abdullah Ibrahim. He's from South Africa. A little bit late. Jazz combo is going to play for you this morning are all compositions by Abdullah Ibrahim. The first number used to be his theme song, and it's pronounced Zwake. I'm not sure. I'm going to find out later. And I think it's named after his son, who will also be here. We'd like to continue with the number called Chizo. I'm not sure if that's how you pronounce it either, but I'll find that. Chizo? Thank you. Thank you. many years, and she'd like to talk to you a little bit about that. Mrs. Levine.
Coming home from work, and other people trying to give them rides and being stopped by the police. And I just suddenly felt that here I was, this was my country, I was part of this. And this was, if all these people were struggling so hard against the government and the repression, that this is certainly something that I could try to do with my life in some small way to help with this. So this, what I'm really trying to say is it was that teacher that made that connection for me between what is happening, what I read through the newspapers, and made me actually go and make that effort to see what was happening around me in my country. And you're never too young, all of you, when you're 8, 9, 10, you can begin to start to think about these things, to think about people living around you, what their lives are like, how do they compare to your life, is there anything you can do about it to help with the injustice and the inequality. So that's just a story about life in South Africa when I was much, much younger. Enjoy the concert.
Abdullah Ibrahim was born in Cape Town. We're going to play a tune that our next tune that we play is called Joan Cape Town Flower. But if you please help me welcome Abdullah Ibrahim. Thank you. Thanks. That featured Josh Summers on alto saxophone. Lee Johnstone on tenor sax. Pat Linsky on trombone. Let me introduce the rest of the band to you. Paul Frey on trumpet. Leonard Schmerich on electric bass and percussion. Mitch Gelber, electric bass and percussion. Pat Dundas, drums and percussion. Greg Perret, drums and percussion. Andy Barish, drums and percussion. Ben Spencer on string bass. And Tim Weedman on piano. Pleasure for the Jazz Conference to play for the lower school, and it's a real pleasure, I think, for the first time ever, perhaps, playing for the middle school. Thank you, middle school. We'd like to close with a tune called Sweet Samba. Thank you.
That song was written in exile. You know, that first period of exile was about 9 years from 65, no, from 62. And then the second period was 76, no? 76. So last year. And The Wedding was written during the second period, in 1976. It is was written for a the songs are not written not written out of context of everything else that happens. So all of the songs, there's some interrelationship with each other. There's nothing that really stands on its own. As a piece, perhaps, but in thought and in in chronology connected. The wedding, during the uprising and during the war in Sarajevo, there were a lot of young people who had to leave the country. And most of them went into the camps, into the military camps. So this song is really the story of a young man and a young woman in South Africa, about your age at school, and they get involved with the young man gets involved with in the struggle, and of course he hears that the police are looking for him, and he has to leave the country. So the night that he prepares to leave the country, the underground, he and girlfriend have their last meeting, and they establish this bond. No matter what happens, that eventually someday you will return. And that this song will serve as a link between them. So actually, it is a within the context of ourselves, wherever we are in the world, it's just a context. It's the bond between loved ones, you know, on whatever. Mm-hmm. It's a song of love on whatever level. And we thought the avenue to call it the wedding, because the wedding signifies that bond between people, individuals, or communities. And it's become functional because the people have utilized the song in weddings, mm-hmm. all over the world.
There's somebody who's coming tonight who said they asked you to play at their wedding, and you said they would. You said you would, and they haven't set a date yet. Maybe he's coming to ask you again tomorrow.
Well, why don't they ask the unit? Yeah, that's an idea. That's an idea. We're going to get a band to play the reception.
It's funny, I play a lot of weddings, but I usually play New York.
Yeah, there's, about 2 years ago, we played a tour in Austria. There was a young man came up and gave me an arrangement of the wedding for brass band. He was out of a small village out in Austria. Where, and what he told me is that people have been listening to the record and using the record, using the song,
mm-hmm. for
weddings. And because they don't have the only units that are really out there in those villages are brass bands. So they asked him to arrange a wedding for brass bands. And apparently it's been played all over Austrian villages.
What's his name? The guy that Jacob Spilo, he's a jazz musician. But when he had to do some music for a wedding, he used the wedding.
Yeah. Well, if I ever get married again, maybe I'll use that.
Wonderland, Jacob Spilo.
Oh, yeah. Oh, sorry, what was that?
Oh, I just made a bad joke. I said, if I ever get married again, maybe I'll use it too. Would you play a tune with the group?
What do you want to play?
Sweet Sound, or?
Oh, he's cooking on that.
Oh, no.
What else do you have?
Let's see. Well, you heard the Homecoming. The Chisa?
Chisa.
Chisa? What is that? Where does that come from?
Chisa. South Africa. Chisa is a... Chisa actually means warm or hot. And it was this song. There's normally playing dances like the last song in the band, it was like for 1 hour, 2 hours. Because the idea is the ideas with the music from home is repetitive quality, and becomes hypnotic. It's like, cycling. Mm-hmm. And every time you hit that first figure again, it takes on a completely another dimension. Of course, when people are dancing, it's even more exciting. because you as a musician, where you play, you're locked into the dancers, as a group of specific dancers. The tenor plays, but lady dancing. Remember Columbus? Tenor player. When I first started playing years. He was playing much older than us, an established tenor player, and he used to play with harmonics. But at that time, they used to call it squeaks. I was just saying to you, but Columbus, why? Everybody said, you're such a beautiful tone, playing such beautiful melodies, beautiful improvisation. Why must you use the squeak? We could never understand it. Of course, when I came here, it was a... Remember when we got into the stage, to do that period, they called avant-garde. It was in the 60s in New York City. So the musician started playing this harmonics. I remember, what's his name, Pharaoh. Pharaoh sounded. And when there was a South African guy, took him and said, hey man, you remember Columbus played this stuff long ago? Played this avant-garde so long ago. And it always worried me, so I had to clarify this with Columbus, I went back. I mean, this is like 20, 30 years apart. So I went back home, I asked Columbus, I said, somebody, do you know what the hell with the alien? What you guys are doing? He said, yeah, I love this stuff. You know what, playing this stuff. And I said, yeah, man, how? These squeaks that you want, used to call squeaks. What was that about? Not technical, I'm trying to take the place. So he said to me, Do you remember Mona? I said, yeah. I mean, she was a beautiful woman. And when she walked in with her partner, he did the dance like everybody was doing. So Columbus said to me, you used to play every time when Mona walked in, I don't know where the sounds came from. So these were the squeaks that we were here, but we couldn't connected with this lady, So if you play like cheese, if you play it for dances, it has a, playing for a concert is one thing, playing for dance it's another connotation. I think that's where, at least when you have that experience. Sometimes for the musicians now, it's problematic because everybody wants the solo. And perhaps it's because that dance experience is not there. Even if we used to play swing, there was the riff. It was the riffs that really got me. The solo was just in there to add another color. Then when you came back to the riff, it was started the dances on another level. Yeah, do you want to dance?
Me?
No, it's my
These are the
Thank you.
other classes. So they're going to have to leave.
Yeah, then it was piano at home, so about age of about four, I think I started touching on the piano. And then the normal thing that the local school teacher looked at them for lessons, to learn how to read the basic rudiments of music. So the first inspiration is really in the family. And local musicians, I mean, the names wouldn't mean anything to you.
Were there any American artists that inspired you?
Well, South Africa is very unique because of its geographic, political, from the geographic and political perspective, it's almost like fulcrum between East and West. You know the geography and where Cape Town is. I was born in Cape Town, raised in Cape Town. So you have a wide range of cultural experience. You have the music of the Hoi or the San, Hoi and San people in the Cape. The Hoi San is the so-called Bushmen or Hottentot people. These are the original inhabitants of South Africa. Very remarkable, incredible people. taking the whole social dynamic to a very, very high level. The Hoi healers, traditional healers, trance dance healers are probably the most highly developed healers anywhere in the planet. So there's the Hoi music. You're exposed to Khoza, part of Khoza Nation. This is Madiba's people. Nelson Mandela, Khoza people. Then Zulu, Papedi, Shangaan. So many Sutu, so many different tribes. Just within say 1,000 miles square from Cape Town to Johannesburg, we have all of that. And then you have the Eastern influence. It was basically during the Dutch East India dynamic, where the Dutch used to sail around the Cape. When the routes across Asia were cut off because of the people like Genghis Khan and the Mongols, they decided to go around. So the Cape became very, very important strategic point. So everybody sailed around the Portuguese, the Spanish, Arabs, the Danes, and of course then there was a whole trade route established between Europe and called the East Indies, which is Java, Indonesia, Batavia, because of the spices trade. And this route came around the Cape. And of course, with the Dutch, the colonial forces, wherever they went, they were met with resistance. One of the places where they were met with resistance was in the East Indies. So a lot of those people were brought to Cape Town as prisoners. And they developed in Cape Town a Muslim community. These people were basically Muslims. And they became now what is known as the Cape Malay. So you have that influence of that. Then of course you have the British, the French, Spanish, and
later was American musicians, American music. American music was there even before the advent of television or radio. It was also because of the ships. Who was the one who went to Japan? Commodore Perry. Remember? Mission to Japan and stopped at the Cape. In fact, some of the traditions, like the carnival tradition, what do you call it? The minstrel traditions were transported to the Cape. In fact, in Cape Town now we still have minstrel troops and carnival around New Year's time. So basically, based on American minstrel shows. And when golden diamonds were discovered, a lot of ragtime pianists came from the United States, especially to Kimberley's diamond mining center. So all that influence is there. Then you have the influence from the rest of Africa. So we're fortunate to have a very wide range of cultural, cross-cultural dynamic. Go ahead. In about 50 years time, the music that I play will be regarded as the traditional music of this era. There's the different dynamics that occur here. Some of the music, like the song that we played, Chisa. This is a traditional song, traditional Cape South African song. Most of the music I play are my own compositions. I'm a composer. We are blessed and cursed by colonialism. We're all victims of it, one way or some way or the other. Most of the music that you hear now, comes out of urban Africa, because we've been urbanized. If you hear most of the music that comes out of South Africa, for example, is urban music played with Western instruments. So we reflect what is happening in the urban community. Most of the people here only have the urban experience. This is happening in Africa as well. People are drawn into the cities. The music is basically transformed. Whatever is happening in the rural areas or on the farmland or in the communities on the land are translated into the urban experience. We play Western instruments, for example. So if you say to what extent it has been changed, we all have been changed by it. Unless you have, basically you have people who play traditional instruments like Fude Musa or the kora players of West Africa, or the Makoyani players of Swaziland. But basically, we have all had to adapt to the contemporary global urban situation. But as for myself, most of the music that I play are my own compositions.
Why did you choose to convert to Islam, and how did that affect
the
music?
Well, if you're a new musician, especially this music that we play, it's another way of being. See, precisely because we play acoustic instrument. If you have like a synthesizer, it's very easy to sound good, even if you don't know much. You know what I mean? You can plug it in and play your press button. It's there. With acoustic instruments, it takes many, many years to perfect the instrument. Even if you play so-called European classical music. Now, you know, with European classical music, at least you have a whole library of, you say if you're a violin player, you know, there is a whole culture of European classical music that you can choose from if you want to find guidelines. You can play Bach, you can play Mozart, everything's written for those instruments. The saxophone, for example, is a predominantly jazz instrument. Compared to other instruments, again, it's an urban, it's an instrument that was born in the urban, this modern urban society. So, if you're a musician, we deal with improvisation. So it means that you don't have many guidelines. Now, of course, your generation, you have many possibilities because those of us who have gone before have established some kind of culture. You know, so now young musicians now can get Bird, you know, you can get Charlie Parker, you can get a book, you can get Coltrane, is there, but we grew up having to produce that stuff first, right? So you had no guidelines. You had no guidelines, so you had to develop even now. And of course, it becomes even more pronounced when you're a composer. Right? You're a composer, and then you have to improvise. So you have to develop your own system, and this you have to do through trial and error. So you need, for this, you need a lot of serenity. You need time to work with your instrument. Now, in this modern diaspora that we live, it's virtually impossible. You wouldn't be surprised how it is that musicians, jazz musicians, are able to overcome the social problems and still sound that good. So there are all the pitfalls that come with it. So because you need this kind of serenity, the community doesn't allow it, you grow up in ghettos, vicious ghettos, you grow up under vicious systems like we had to do under apartheid. So, within all of this context, you have to find some way to maintain balance and to be creative. So, I find many people turn to drugs. Now, I was one of the fortunate ones that, I mean, the furthest I got was smoke pot, you know. But in South Africa, everybody smokes it because we come out of it. Always everybody smokes it because we come out of a traditional society. The people found us, they're smoking the stuff. They say, what's the problem? But of course, when you talk now in an agricultural situation or agricultural society, perhaps it can be condoned if you have to deal with this stuff. Right? If you have to deal with modern society, the disadvantages of having to rely on that stuff, it really outweighs the advantages. That's why you find that many jazz musicians die at a very early age. Bird died when he was 34. Coltrane, Monk, young people, young men, young women, Billie Holiday. Now, These are the pressures that are put on you as a creator within the society. Now, we are fortunate because we can relate to it. We can still see in Africa what the role of the musician was before the advent of this colonial period. I mean, this is in all traditional societies. In Africa, we call griots. You know, you understand what a griot is. A griot is really the function of the musician is as a historian. So if you want to know what happened on the 17th of December of 1520, you go to the griot. And he's I can sing the song. This is how the music is recorded. Now, the music is, as a musician, your function in the community was either you provided music for social occasions or you provided music for devotion or healing. And then these three aspects. Now, in the traditional, in this traditional society, you had no problem. You were immediately, when you showed at an early age some signs of having musical ability, you were immediately drawn into these three disciplines. You see. It was accepted in the community, and the community supported you. If you're a musician in this community, in this society, now it has changed a little bit. If you show any signs of being a musician, yeah, people will try to steer you the other way. You know what I mean? You become a doctor, become a lawyer, because the society does not provide or support the musician, not in the context of being a musician, but in the wider context of what the function of the musician is supposed to be. See, my great-grandfather was a traditional healer. He taught us all about the herbs, plants, spoke all the language, African languages fluently. So when you become a jazz musician, you are thrust into a completely alien, different culture. And I mean from the spiritual point of view, it's completely alien to you. So we look around. Coltrane went east. In his later years, he discovered Buddhism. Many musicians become born again Christians. Right now, there are many musicians who have accepted the Buddhist faith. For me, it was Islam. For me, it was Islam, because you have to have some explanation within yourself on how it is that you have this talent to create this music, because music is a very strange thing. It affects millions of people. I mean, we're sitting here, and something which you cannot touch, it's intangible, you cannot see it. I cannot hand it over to you, maybe on a disc or something. You listen to it. Something that's intangible, it cannot be, and yet it's so powerful. So you are dealing with the unseen. Music is something that is like this physical body you can see, so there must be something that you can't see. Yeah? So you're dealing with the unseen, and the society has not dealt with that, on what the role is of a musician or somebody talented. And for me, it was discovering Islam, because in Africa, it follows that if you're a musician, you're Muslim. Africa is what, 80, 90%?
80% Muslim. In some places, it's actually like 99% Muslim.
Yeah. Yeah.
How would you define jazz? I have difficulty separating jazz from classical music, from pop music, from...
The key of jazz music is improvisation. It's improvising. That's why not many people want to deal with it, you see. Because you have to think. You know, the classical music, it's there, it's written for you. You don't have to worry, you can perfect it, you know. With a little practice, you can perfect it. This is why the music is very close with traditional societies, for example, like with the Japanese. You know, we have
our culture is very closely affiliated with all traditional cultures. Japanese, for example, I've been studying martial arts now, Japanese martial arts for the last 25 years. And it has the same principle, isn't it? So that's the same principle. The principle is that, I don't know if you know anything about the Japanese culture, we have that very famous swordsman, Musashi, Miyamoto Musashi, very famous swordsman. And Musashi wrote a book on sword strategy. It's called A Book of Five Rings. But actually, the five rings means the five elements, you know, water, earth, fire, and so on. So the principle is that if you are approached with fire, you throw water, the water will extinguish the fire. This is the basic principle of the martial arts. Now Musashi said, and of course you know that nowadays all business people use this book in business. That's what strategy. Now Musashi said, under the sword lifted high, there is hell to make you tremble. But go ahead anyway, and you will find bliss. Now this is jazz. Yeah. Because okay, if you have your opponent there, your opponent is standing with a sword, right? You're facing your opponent, you're scared of hell. Now Musashi says, no. Don't worry about the sword. Go ahead, and you will find bliss. Now, jazz music is exactly the same thing. You have a theme there that you learn. You learn how to play this theme, the song. Then it has a set of rules, a set of sequences that you hopefully know. So when you finish the theme, now you're going to improvise. Now the first note that you play in that improvisation, you have no idea of what's going to go on. You have no, I mean, this is complete submission. You have no idea of what's, and I think this is what makes people afraid, is that fear of the unknown. And this is especially, for example, this is why sports are so popular. As I see now, there's at least some kind of some discussion going on about the role of sports. Really? Because this whole idea of winning and losing, you know, it doesn't really make any sense. Because the thing is that, see, there are millions of people in this world, yeah? And you can hear somebody's voice anywhere in the world and be able to recognize it. Millions of people. So it means that everyone has something unique, as you know, you have your own unique voice. So what is the competition there for? The idea of sport is that you must win at all costs. There is a winner, there must be a loser. So there's always this playing up of one person against the other, but the sense is that everyone has its own, his or her own particular voice. And maybe it cannot say what that person says, but definitely it can say something else. No? And for us, this is the principle of jazz is really to project you as an individual, you know, and the beauty within you as an individual, regardless of what anybody else says.
What made you decide to finally go back to South Africa?
Well, it's not a question of me deciding. You know, we all lent our support to the struggle, and there came a point in time when it was decided by the command that this was the right thing to do after Nelson Mandela's release.
Can you say you're most influenced by and who you listen to now, who's had a big effect on you?
No, I don't listen to music anymore. Really, I I used to listen to records and listen to, I don't listen to it anymore.
When you started asking, were you listening to?
Everything. Everything. I know what you're asking me. Perhaps I should answer you. You're a musician. Somebody once asked John Coltrane, he said, Coltrane, which book must I use? And John said, all the books. So this is, you listen to everything. I mean, in formative stage, you are trying to establish or find your own direction. So you listen to everything. And then when you found it, then you open up your heart to listen to the hearts of other people, to people and not to music.
Music is used for various purposes. People play it for pleasure and listen to it for pleasure. But I'm wondering if you could comment about the healing power of music.
Yeah. Okay. So the original instrument is the voice. But with an instrument you can translate, you see, you have a formula. If somebody is ill, you can have a formula in terms of medicine, which means that you mix different herbs. Now there's a formula for that. You know, the doctor has studied over, the formula has been passed on from generation to generation on how, what to use. It's a secret. For example, now if you play drummer, you can translate that same information into rhythm. The very same information. You can translate that the same information into color. Artist. Okay. The most effective one is the voice. Because everything is within the voice. So we were traditional healers in Africa, we have what we call healing songs. We actually sing the song. Because every human being is created on the same formula. Exactly the same formula. The different hair, the different color, the different nose, this is only for identification. You know, and because of the geography of the earth, because the earth is round. This is why people look differently, because of climatic conditions, nothing else. But the basic formula for the human being is the same anywhere in the world. You can apply it to yourself. If you make the sound, the sound vibrates in the heart. Nowhere else. It doesn't vibrate in the back or in the head or here. We make it vibrates here. If you make the sound, ooh, it vibrates here. Ooh. If you make the sound, it vibrates in the head. Okay. So, a lot has to do with language. Traditional language has all of those secrets in it. If you look at the word love, in all traditional languages, the word love has the sound of ah in it. All traditional languages. If you pause up, people say tanto, ah. Except, of course, the Germanic languages, they have the sound E. when I was in Japan, I asked the Japanese people, I said, how do you say love? They say ai. You're smart. You know, ah, and then I said, ah, and so I said, oh, they hit E. So the science of healing through music is very, very deep. We just gave you a little insight.
Thanks for the talk. very much.
Thank you.
Town Flower, and some of you may know Abdullah hails from Cape Town, South Africa. And I found out recently, this afternoon, this was named for his sister-in-law.
Thank you. Let me introduce the students to you. Josh Summers on alto sax. Paul Frey, trumpet. Reed Johnstone, tenor sax. Pat Yahinsky, trombone. Leor Schneerson, electric bass and percussion. In the back of the bongo, the congas there, it's Andy Barrett on drums and percussion. Pat Dundas, drums and percussion. Mitch Gelber, electric bass and percussion. Greg Paré, drums and percussion. Ben Spencer, electric bass. Upright bass, how could I miss that one? Tim Lichtman on piano. Just a little word about the group. I'm certainly real proud of them. 2 weeks ago, they didn't know these tunes. So with a lot of work and a lot of inspiration from the music of Abdullah Ibrahim, we've come a long way in 2 weeks. We are available because we're trying to take a tour. In fact, just recently, we got invited to South Africa. So, I don't know if you pulled that one off, but very recently that happened. So, okay, we're going to continue with a tune by guess who? By entitled The Homecoming.